So Roberto, it's a pleasure to see you again.
Yes, after our French experience.
Right, in Perpignan in 2012, right. And here we are in Italy in 2013. And I really enjoyed meeting you last year and hearing some of your stories as someone born in the Jehovah's Witnesses. And I just really appreciate you taking a moment to share some of your experience and some of your thoughts with me. So if you don't mind, tell me, you were born in?
Yeah, I would say basically born, because I was two and my parents embraced that new faith. Mm-hmm. So for me, it has always been that way.
Right. And where were you? What country was
it? It was Alexandria in Egypt. Mm. The activity of Jehovah's Witnesses was under ban. Mm. So I have gone with my family difficult times. Mm-hmm. In the sense that everything we did, as far as religion is concerned, was against the law.
Uh-huh. That must have been interesting.
Oh, yeah.
But because we don't have a lot of time, you were involved for how many years total?
I left when I was 59, so it gives you an idea about...
Well, and how long ago is that?
It was in 2004, mm-hmm. when I quit... without breaking officially, mm-hmm. just disappearing, fading out.
So you were involved for 50 years.
Yes.
And in 2004, you just said, that's it.
Well, I said, that's not the truth I thought it was. Oh. That's when I decided to abandon the cult.
So when I was with you last year, you were doing a presentation about the apocalypse, right. And the presentation that the world was going to come to an end any moment. But to cut to the chase, what really intrigued me was you told me that you were kind of a senior Jehovah's Witness official.
Absolutely.
Well, you were a circuit overseer?
No, I was a circuit assembly overseer.
Uh-huh.
Which is the administration, if you want, of the conventions, mm-hmm. and circuits, were about 1,200, 1,500 people, uh-huh. made up of 20-odd congregations.
Uh-huh.
I was an elder in one of the congregations. I was, in fact, the presiding overseer. But as far as this administration of the convention, I was the circuit assembly overseer.
Okay, so 50 years... achieved some major status within the organization, but you also told me you were a corporate executive, which I found fascinating.
I wonder how I managed, in fact, to be both.
Well, that's part of why I wanted to interview you, because I've experienced so many very intelligent, educated people who are able to do very complex jobs on the one hand.
Yeah.
But then be in a totalistic mind control group on the other hand, unable to reality test and make their own decisions. So,
professionally,
yes,
I had to have a very, very critical mind,
mm-hmm.
because I was when I was younger, I was the market analyst, so mm-hmm. I had to study the markets and come up with conclusions on why the trend for black TV moving to color TV, that was the field at that
wow.
time. But I was very young at that time. But then I moved into business analyst, evaluating the different strategies the company would follow to be productive and earn the money.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I ended with very, very important jobs in information systems, where my job was essentially project manager, but my job was to understand why we had a given opportunity problem. An opportunity to improve the efficiency of the company, mm-hmm. and come up with relatively intelligent solutions which would enable the management to fund millions of dollars in project I was proposing.
Is it okay to say what country you were working in as a businessman?
I was working in Switzerland for 38 years with a multinational company, mm-hmm. American company, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoyed a very, very very good recognition from the company. I quit on an early retirement and was very happy to be able to use my time for the religion. But in fact, it ended up the other way around. Mm. I started to use the time for myself.
Interesting. So tell me, because you told me this when we were together last, what happened in 1975? Because you shared the story. You said something about a woman recently coming to you who was there in your congregation. Just a summary.
Yeah, the summary is that being one of the leaders in the congregation, and because of that position, we had several opportunities during the months to encourage the congregation to do more work because the end was coming, etc. And in our in relation with the congregation, we used publications of the Watchtower.
Right.
One of them is called the Kingdom Ministry, which was studied every week, mm-hmm. once a week, and it was a monthly publication. Mm-hmm. Was pointing, it was June 74, was pointing to the very few months left before Armageddon, etc., that people were selling their houses to start preaching or dedicating more time to the preaching work. Mm. That sister, who finally, after many years, came back to me, reminded me how serious I was in that presentation that evening, that she was so shocked about what the magazine, not the magazine, but the internal bulletin said about the urgency of the end, that she also felt that she had to sell her stuff and start this kind of pioneer work. And when she told me that, she was not anymore a Jehovah's Witness, as I, and she came telling me, "You remember when you said that and that?" I said, "I can't remember. Did I really say that?" I went back to my library, and guess what? I found the bulletin with all the notes I had to get to deliver the talk.
And then it reminded
you. She was right.
It reminded you. And I remember I asked you what happened after, when Armageddon didn't happen. Did it cause you to lose any faith?
Absolutely not.
Isn't that amazing?
It is. Today, I say, how did I do that?
You know? Right.
But when the thing happens, you don't realize, because you said, okay, maybe it's not tomorrow, but definitely soon. It's coming soon, and maybe God is giving us more time so we engage more thoroughly into this activity. And as the time goes by, you finally lose track that you had a given date which was not met.
Right. Well, they deliberately want you, I think, to suppress, groups want you to suppress any doubts or critical thoughts.
And especially because after, they deny that they gave so much emphasis
to that day. Because new light came, etc.
And new people came.
New people
who didn't know anything about it and believe only what you hear.
And you're not supposed to tell them, by the way, we used to preach.
Yeah, but we didn't even think about it, It was not something which you look at it in a critical way. No way. Absolutely not. Only now.
So I know I could speak with you for hours, but we're already hearing the bell to reassemble. Tell me how you came to decide to leave after decades of involvement and leadership.
I think that this can happen only if an unexpected event tells you that something is wrong. Mm-hmm. And that unexpected event to me happened when what I expected from the organization as a reaction to a problem which arose in the congregation, they didn't act according to the rules they were pretending me to act when people committed sins, etc. And I started to wonder why. And my question, which came to my mind, and I meditated on it months after months, is how come that these people who pretend to be God's only channel react in this way? I analyzed what I knew were the evidence to support this concept, and believe it or not, I said, it's not possible. With all these years, I never sat down and actually for myself, with a critical mind, examined it. When I did, and I realized that this cannot be God's only organization, the next moment, I stopped going to meetings, and it was November 2004.
So it was like your professional self that had all of these analytic tools. It applied to the top leadership, the governing body, and you said they're not doing what they said we're supposed to do. They're not following their own rules.
Absolutely.
And if they're not following their own rules, what's the hypocrisy and the contradictions? And you left with your wife and other people?
Well,
what was that like?
You know, we're a family of three kids, and some were married, etc. And the event I was talking about was a problem which put the whole family in a bad light in front of the congregation. So, and all the family then reacted more or less in the same way, at different times, of course. But I was officially declared non-Jehovah Witness, which means you can start to shun the man, ostracizing.
This fellowship.
This fellowship. Yeah. In fact, it was not really this fellowship. It was dissociated because I didn't have it as a judicial committee. So I was dissociated in April 2009, 5 years after I left. But my family did not follow necessarily the same pattern. My kids were disfellowshipped at different times. So that's more or less the type of situation my family is in.
So it's now July 6, 2013. I've been told that the Watchtower Society has been shifting their doctrine in the last few weeks even. Are you aware of any policy changes or theological changes?
Well, there are serious changes, very serious. But the trouble is that the individual in the organization doesn't even realize that those are basic changes.
Right, but for the sake of the audience, can you just say, as someone who spent decades, what do you think is some maybe the big ones?
I mean, to me, the biggest one is that the entity which was pointed at as being the channel between God and human beings at the top of the organization were the so-called members of the 144,000 anointed.
That's what I heard.
And all of a sudden, and of these, of course, we know how many they are because annually they reported in the yearbook, and they were about 8,000 or so at that time. All of a sudden, it was not anymore that crowd of people who were the discreet,
faithful and
discreet slain. But it was only the governing body of about 10 people. So to me, this was a very big change, shift in who is the actual channel between God and human beings. By the way, at that time, I already discounted all that, and I knew already that neither one nor the other.
Right. But I guess for the people, the millions who are still in bondage, or people who are still in the organization, it just, what I would like to do is call their attention to the fact that if an organization says they're doing the eternal, unchanging God's work, and it's all of a sudden changing, it should raise questions as to, is this a real authority worthy of your obedience and your money and your time?
I don't know what kind of comparison I could make. Like saying, for instance, no, the Pope is not anymore what we thought.
Right. No, I think that's a good analogy. Any last thoughts you may want to say to anyone? Maybe someone is born in the Jehovah's Witnesses, is starting to have doubts, is starting to reach out on the internet and do research. What should they do?
I think the very important thing to remember is that the individuals in the organizations are not the problem. These are nice people. There are also bad people like any otherwhere. They are nice people, and there is nothing wrong with them personally. What is wrong is the type of teachings they not only suggest or propose, they impose on the individual members. And the worst of them, to me at that time, is one which has to do with the secrecy of judicial committees when pedophilia is concerned, and we have the case of Candace County. And the other one is the ostracism, the shunning of members who don't want to continue to have the same faith.
Right.
I'm not talking about the people who committed a sin, but people who changed their mind and don't believe anymore that Armageddon is coming tomorrow.
Right, or they want to celebrate a birthday
or
of a
relative
or something.
We should respect those people and their thought, their opinions, because the Watchtower themselves, that was the actual subject of my conference here, is the Watchtower has fought and won so many court cases, even in front of Supreme Courts, to grant civil rights to the organization as an entity, but the same, identical civil rights are not granted by the organization to the individuals.
I wish I had been at your lecture. Was it videotaped, I hope?
Yes.
Because I want a copy and look on my website. I'll put a link up if I can't get the original videotape.
It was here, by the way, in this hall.
So if you did it, you can ask for a copy.
Yeah, I'll try.
So why not? Any last words as we wrap up and go to our closing session of our conference?
Well, I think I have to sympathize with the people who start to have some doubts. They will have to go through very, very difficult times, because we have gone through them. We start to wonder whether we are displeasing God, whether we're committing a sin against God, when in fact the only thing we're doing is challenging the position other people have taken in front of God. So don't feel guilty. Just take a chance to open your mind and with the best peaceful mind you can, have the necessary analysis done and take an action which is not suggested by somebody, but by your own critical mind.
Right. Well, for me, there are so many people like yourself who did leave 10 years ago, even longer. Randy Waters, for example, left Bethel. He was an elder at Bethel. So you're not alone, and you don't have to reinvent the wheel. And for me, I learned about Jehovah's Witnesses as a destructive mind control group back in 1989. So I've worked with many people, actually, so that they don't have to go through a doubting and, you know, guilt and phobias.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just to learn about mind control and phobias will help a lot. And just because you leave and your family hasn't doesn't mean you can't do things to try to help your family in the future. In fact, many of the former leaders that I've been interacting with in the last month have predicted there's going to be a huge walkout. So many people in the coming weeks and months because of this change of theology.
Yeah.
So we'll wait and see if that happens. I hope it does, obviously. You probably do too.
Yeah, definitely I do. But the important thing is that the individual doesn't feel guilty and participate wherever they can to help others to get the same freedom they are now enjoying.
Yeah, so, I mean, I left the Moonies. I don't feel guilty for helping people get out of the Moonies.
Right.
So, thank you again, Roberto.
Steven, it was a pleasure to meet you again, and I hope maybe next year
and
in
more.
Washington.
And maybe we'll do a workshop together and get a whole bunch of people together and teach Robert Lifton's model and Margaret Singer's model and Mike Bite model. Thank you, Roberto.
Excellent. Thank you.